So I want to do something of a review. One thing we bypassed that we should talk about maybe next time is the paper by Tillich, How Science Changed Man's View of Himself. And that's a big gulp. But it's such an interesting effort to characterize three major periods in Western history: the ancient, the Renaissance, and the modern period. And he had an amazing style. I mean, he approached these with a conceptual aptitude that I always found unique, because he could formulate how to talk about large periods like that. In fact, I went to hear him once give a talk on periodization in history, and how you formulate periods. And they're always, controversial, because it's difficult to demarcate specific periods. I mean, we did it beginning with Galileo. That seems to me perfectly obvious. And there's a huge turn that Galileo represents. My friend Ralph Abraham calls it a bifurcation, a kind of a cut, and something new starts. And so Galileo is marvelous as far as the beginning of the European Renaissance and the Italian Renaissance. And the term new is used across the board practically in the time of the Renaissance. So they had an amazing understanding of a new period of history beginning with themselves, such that it was called the Renaissance, and it had to do with the rediscovery of the ancient sources. That was a big eye-opener and a big plus for scholarly work in the Renaissance, and so on and so forth. So Tillich has an amazing ability to characterize these three major periods, and then he winds up, as far as science informing this late period in the history of Western thought, and he says that science is characterized by not having any purpose or aim. That's difficult to really digest, because I don't think you'd have scientists agreeing with that very much. But Tillich means that in a more philosophical sense, as far as science getting rid of the old notion that comes from the Greeks, and especially Aristotle, that things have an inner aim. And there was a whole movement of thought that came from that with the Greeks called teleology. And telos is the Greek word for aim. And things were thought to have an inner aim that was actualized as they grew and fulfilled themselves. It's the major terms, those are the major terms for Aristotle's philosophy, the actualization of potentialities, like the acorn to the oak. That's always given as one of the most telling examples of the fulfillment of potentialities. You start with a little acorn, you get an oak tree. And so Aristotle was very much enamored of that terminology, and it's partly because his father was an herbalist and an herbal physician to the court. When I found that out, I thought, oh, I get it. Aristotle is really kind of an incipient botanist in his orientation. And that's the difference between Aristotle and Plato. Plato was a mathematician in his inner orientation. And so the difference between the two is enormous as far as those respective orientations pertains to them. And then Aristotle becomes critical through the whole Middle Ages. Thomas Aquinas uses him as the basis for Christian doctrine. So Aristotle is kind of the first floor. That's what is known naturally by human effort. And then Aquinas puts theology and the dogmatics of the Roman Church on top of Aristotle. So with Galileo, you get a rejection of Aristotle. It's starting to become clear that Aristotle was wrong on a lot of things, especially heliocentrism as opposed to geocentrism. So the Copernican revolution was enormous in its effect on culture. And Galileo is one of the first to really pick up on that. So anyhow, the Tillich piece is worthy of discussion at some point, as is the piece by Eric Vogelin, What is Scientism? And that's a little tricky, because he indicts scientists who pursue scientism and who are physicalists with being eunuchs. And they sacrifice their balls for the sake of the kingdom of science. I mean, who's ever said that before? I mean, that's as radical as you can get. But it's all part of Vogelin's theme that he carries through many volumes of work. He was an extremely prolific writer. That science is really part of, what does he call it? Well, anti-spiritual revolt. And that's so critical to physicalism, as far as I can tell, that it's pretty obvious. And we'll step that off a little bit today again. Namely, how would you characterize this anti-spiritualist revolt? Well, we started out with Galileo and undermining the sacraments. And that's what the church was really worried about, I think, more so than the fact that he was a Copernican. They sensed that his atomism, which Galileo was one of the first to pick up on in the Renaissance period, reducing things to the smallest part, and he got it from Lucretius, who transmits Democritus, the old Greek atomist, to the Renaissance. We have one little piece in your reader called Swerve. It was a book that written about 2 or 3 years ago on Lucretius and the effect that he had when he was translated for the Renaissance audience, including Galileo. And so atomism undermined the miracle of the Eucharist. I don't know, do you guys get it? I mean, do you follow that argument, that you don't really have the transubstantiation of the bread and wine into the body and blood of Jesus Christ if they're atoms?
Yeah, I don't get it. Why does it necessarily negate?
Well, I think part of the problem of understanding it, you have to know something about what Aristotle meant by substance and accidents. So there's something about substance that conveys the miracle, because without the changing of the bread and the wine into actual flesh and blood, which obviously doesn't happen, but it's considered to be the body and blood of Christ. So that's the substance of it. So the accidents remain, and the substance is what's changed. And it doesn't work with atomism. I can't exactly tell you why. Because there's no substance accident issue with atoms. And so I was thinking about the painting of Raphael of the miracle of the Eucharist. You ought to look it up. I mean, in a way, it is the miracle. It's one of the greatest paintings in the history of Western art. And the chalice conveying the wine and the blood is at the center of this very large painting. And it is really just an absolute expression of the miracle of the Eucharist and what's known as the doctrine of transubstantiation. Now, to me, that meant a sacramental relation to nature. I just want to pick up and abstract from that the notion of sacrament, because it meant you had a reverence for it. There was something sacred about nature that entailed a sacramental relation. Just as the bread and wine are transformed into the body and blood, you have the same issue with baptism, where the water of baptism is sacramental water and entails the symbolism of almost the amniotic fluid in which we swim for 9 months, and the whole symbolism of water. And it's just amazing that the first word of Greek philosophy is water. So you have the sacrament of baptism as far as symbolic, sacred water. It isn't just water. It's mythic, symbolic water. And it conveys a new birth in the operation of it. Yeah.
Were there people in the church who actually developed that kind of, were there any people in the church that actually developed that kind of relationship to nature?
How do you mean? Were there any people?
Well, like philosophers or theologians or any...
Well, you have the Doctrine of the Sacraments. There's a huge literature on that in terms of church writings. That's really one of the most amazing reflections I think you can think about. I mean, what's going on as far as Jesus giving bread and wine to his disciples and saying, this is my body, this is my blood, and do this in remembrance of me, and then that's repeated in every church service every Sunday throughout Christendom?
Right, but did they have any of the kind of modern idea of the fact that this should lead to taking better care of the environment and nature?
You'd think so. I can't think of anybody exactly that returned to... It may be St. Francis. Now, St. Francis embodied these ideas and was someone who transmitted them, and so there was this whole Franciscan development from the life of St. Francis that meant you sacrifice yourself to reverencing other people and nature and all of its creatures and so on. So it goes back, like I began the course with, the doctrine of creation in the book of Genesis. I mean, I don't want to let go of that. I mean, I like the Genesis account of creation. I like the symbolism of creation. I like the image of men and women created in the image of God. I mean, that's what it says. And that gets obscured by the fall. And that's too bad. I mean, original sin, in a way, clouds the original affirmation of the goodness of creation. The original affirmation of the unambiguous goodness of creation. And it's a pity that the two accounts are conflated and people read them as if they're one when in fact they're different accounts. Adam is created, man and woman are created in the image of God in the first account, and Adam is created from the dust of the ground in the second account. And then Eve is created from the rib of Adam. So anyhow, that's just still plays a big part in people's imagination. And I've got this book that I've gotten a big bang out of. It's called The Religion of Technology. And how the original Adam is now the image of technology. I mean, they want to create the God-man. And you get that kind of talk. Stuart Brand is one who's quoted saying that we should be gods. And that other guy who takes all the vitamins, the singularity guy.
Kurzweil?
Yeah, Kurzweil. I mean, he's another one. So this guy goes through a whole account of how it came out of the medieval monastics. They were the first technologists. And his argument is that it excludes females because of Adam, man, with a capital M. And it's these celibate monastic monks that were the first development of technology in the West. And that this excluded women. And he carries that through this entire book. It's a real persuasive argument. And the first book he wrote was called A World Without Women.
Two things real quick. I like you, unless that was a rhetorical comment on your part about not understanding the threat that Galileo posed to the sacraments. But I don't understand, just from the get-go, the church is walled off from any attack by mechanistic science or atomistic science because it's a sacrament. They've got an invisible shield.
Yeah.
they're out of the running. Science cannot, the church set up, or maybe science and the church set up, okay, this domain here is our material world for science. You guys, we'll let you still have the religious or spiritual world. And it worked both ways. They got to, the scientists got to go on their own way, and the religious people, to a certain extent, felt protected. So if it's a miracle, I mean, again, it's not provable or disprovable by science. So why would they feel, even if science explained in its own terms, they would say, no, that's just your materialism. Why the threat? The other thing is, on your point here, I think the problem is when people who don't really appreciate what some of the sacramental creationist theologians of Christianity say, because they base it on the first priestly account that creation is good. Okay, so you have that to justify that, you know, a sacramental vision is a part of Christianity. It's not anti-ecological, because there are critics like L.L. White, who takes the ecological crisis back and lays it on the doorstep of the church by saying matter is not good, matter is dead, and then, you know, matter doesn't have a soul in it. The scientists take off from that. So he lays it, and a lot of people buy that. And I think the problem is the defense of the religionist is that, well, we have, you know, you can't say that because we have the doctrine that creation is good. And when you ask for, like this gentleman said, who showed us in the church a kind of a philosophical or metaphysical application of that? You don't find it. You have to point to St. Francis. Well, that's all well and good. So they say, well, you got St. Francis and you got this, but that's about all you've got. So if we hear this now, saying this author here says that he lays it on the monks, he lays technology, I mean, they were kind of proto-technologists, so, you know, that's a point for the other side. Okay, they can say, see, the only thing the church has to show for it is these proto-technological monks who are now responsible for our runaway technology. So...
Claire?
Well, I
was just waiting for a response from you, Paul. What do you say?
Look, see what she said.
Okay. Three thoughts. The first one is when you talked about original sin, it reminded me of Matthew Fox and his very different take on a book that I have never read called Original Blessing.
Yeah.
That's a whole different
focus. That's the first account of Genesis.
Yeah. But then when you were talking, I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
Barry.
What is it?
Barry.
I'm Claire. I began to realize that when we're talking about the church and the church fathers and all the people writing, these are all men. We do not have, as far as I know, one woman, and we have a lot of celibate clerics writing. So what are we missing here?
And that's part of it too. See, a feminist could...
And the whole conversation. And then my other thought that I'll just throw out is I know very little about American Indian wisdom and philosophy. But I do know that the earth is considered feminine, and the earth is the mother, and that women are honored in a way in the indigenous tribes that the Western world just didn't have a clue about. So I'm just throwing those ideas out.
There's a direct correlation there.
Yes, there is a direct correlation.
Well, see, that's another attack. The feminists can say this is a patriarchal kind of system on top of everything else. So what's so good about it?
Well, how did you get away with it? That's what I don't understand. You know, up until 1965. It's just, it's kind of stupefying.
I'm a woman, you know.
I went into the herbal industry after teaching here, and so I had to learn the history of herbalism. Well, if there's any subject matter in history that's going to include women, it's going to be herbalism, you know. And Parvati was one of the first herbals that I got my hands on, written by former wife of Rick, and nobody, you know. And finally, I got to Hildegard of Bingen, and this before anybody had discovered her. I mean, I discovered her first as an herbalist, and then her music and her life and so on came through after that. So that was the one woman in the history of Western herbalism that was accounted for because she had a remarkable career. And then they were even making one of her products that she was famous for, called Swedish Bitters. And that was on the recipe of Hildegard of Bingen. So that was a big kick. And what came to mind as Barry was talking was the fact that one of the first resurrection appearances of Jesus is as a gardener. Well, there's a wonderful etching of Rembrandt showing, and what, did he dig himself up out of the grave? I mean, that's a, you know, kind of an odd, and he's mistaken, you know, somebody sees him as a gardener and they don't get it that it's the resurrected Jesus.
And metaphorically, it's pretty cool to see, to think of as a gardener, him sprouting from the earth, so to speak.
I know it, and I told you, one of the mottos that Chadwick and I had was, let our gardens be our graves. And it's partly because I found out from a famous landscape architect writer that gardens began on graves, hence the raised bed.
Oh,
and he told
God.
Me that. Yeah, no kidding.
Wow.
And it was an old kind of theme, largely French theme, about the origins of gardens.
And is that because decomposing bodies made for a better compost?
That beats me. I don't want to think about that.
Certainly nitrogen rich.
Yeah.
Bone meal ready to go.
Yeah, really. So anyhow, yeah.
Well, this point you just mentioned about the herbalist and the tradition of herbalism and women, I think that's important from because of what you said. And I brought this up, I think, in the second class, that there is a patriarchal religious attitude built in, I think that science, you know, is infected with from a patriarchal religion. And this is in this is personified in Roger Bacon, who, during the reign of James I, was the person
You mean Francis Bacon?
I'm sorry, Francis Bacon.
Yeah.
Yes. He was the person who gave Western science its sort of, if not methodology, its attitude. And his attitude was that you interrogate nature,
yeah.
You put her on the rack to
dominate
extract,
and exploit.
To extract her secrets. You torture her secrets out of her. Well, this was no mere metaphor for him, because when he was also for Charles, for James, interrogator for the witches during the witch hunts. So he literally interrogated witches. Now, why is that important? Because witches, as you know, Paul, were keeping the herbalist tradition alive in the Middle Ages and in the modern period. So there you go. There's another connection.
Okay, now we got four or five cans of worms that we've opened here.
Open them all.
And so let's encapsulate them as follows. I'm intrigued by warfare within the history of ideas. So you have the warfare or conflict between physicalism and vitalism. That's the primary warfare for the course of this class. The second one is the warfare between science and religion. And there's a marvelous two-volume study of that warfare. And it's, you know, it's still raging. And that's part of the atheist attack on the part of scientists on religion, calling religion evil. And the sooner we get rid of religion altogether, the better the world will be. And there's the warfare between the ancients and the moderns that came up with Francis Bacon. That's another major warfare. Bacon declares it. We are going to deliver ourselves from Western learning because it's old-fashioned. I mean, it's outmoded. We are setting forth on a new course. He calls it the new instauration. And it's because of the opening up of the brave new world, which we are going to dominate and exploit and master. The mastery of nature is the big theme of Bacon. And he sets the agenda, and it just gets worked out
so
from there.
Did he write Utopia? Is that the same Bacon that wrote?
That was Bacon? Thomas More.
Oh, who? I thought Bacon wrote some sort of explanation of his idea of what science would give mankind in some sort of fictional form of a story about what it was.
No.
Does anybody know what Bacon's?
That's no Bacon. That's. I'm not sure I know what you're talking about.
I'll look it up.
Okay.
Back
so following that split and full circle back to the male monks, you know, I certainly would associate vitalism with the feminine and physicalism with the masculine. Back to, you know, the mess that we're in, I lay at the hands of us goddamn men, mostly. Physicalism, and if we had more of the feminine, we'd have more of the vitalism, and I think we'd be in a better world.
Does anyone know the book Iron John by Robert Bly?
Oh, yeah.
So he talks about how there was there were these four archetypes, and we only really got two of them. There's Mother Earth and Father Sky, and there's also Father Earth and Mother Sky. So there's a challenge. There's a challenge in feminism to feminism, which I am a feminist as well, to say that if we just say there's Mother Earth and Father Sky, and if we paint this as we need to move from male physicalism to female vitalism, we might be recreating the problem. And so what if we were to instead picture vitalism as more of a balance?
What would male vitalism look like?
Well, I can elaborate. So I would say male vitalism would be the nurturing and generative adult male, which is a less common theme in modern United States society.
The stay-at-home father.
excuse me.
Yeah.
If I could make an interpretation of, it seems you mentioned male vitalism as like a tender and starter of recovery. It's almost like reminiscent of an intercourse between male and female organism, when the male is the starter of reproduction, sends the sperm to the female is the bearer. So if you want male and female vitalism, the man has got to establish a restoring ground. It's almost as if the female was planned to maintain it, yet both genders must share the responsibility of nurturing a garden.
I think you're totally on the right track. It's dangerous water, and there's probably some things that, you know, are debatable. It's definitely muddy water. I think you're on the right track. There's a union. There's a unity.
See, and what comes to mind when you say that, John, is that the anomaly of birth is that the female accepts the male sperm, whereas the female immune system should reject it. I don't think they figured that out yet. So the male sperm is actually an antibody, no, an antigen. Yeah, an antigen, namely a foreign substance that the immune system should detect as non-self.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the immune system is built up. The recognition of what you are as opposed to what isn't you. And the immune system goes after everything that is in you. And those are called antigens because they're antibody generating. It's a real clumsy kind of terminology. But all attacks on you are antigens, and they produce the antibodies that are keyed against them. So anyhow, it's an anomaly of birth that the female accepts the sperm without the immune system attacking it as non-self. Claire.
Well, talk about the miracle. I mean, the male church fathers are writing about transubstantiation, but the real miracle is the miracle of birth. And the whole thing, they haven't solved how that happens right now.
That's what I mean.
That's
an immune anomaly.
Have labels for it, but we can't understand it.
Well, that's what it is.
Yeah.
And who was there at these births? In the Middle Ages, it was the midwife.
That is
what
correct.
Were some of the other reasons that were, for burning women? That they were witches. Why? Because they were midwives.
That's right. No, they were healers. I mean, the witch is where the church came in, but they were healers. They were the herbalists. They were the midwives.
Mm.
They bring forth life, and they're at the other end too. And the death end.
Maybe there's some biological perversion explanation for why the woman's body doesn't reject the sperm, and in some way the sperm isn't other, actually. It's somehow the woman's body says, this particular thing is not other, it's actually me too. Hence physical, feminine, and I don't know, I'm almost getting into ridiculous poetics, but the idea of the sperm isn't other, that's why it's part, it's almost like the sperm is feminine, and that's why the woman can't accept it.
Sounds like a mystery of transcendence.
Now where are we?
That was the fourth can, I think.
It's talk like this that makes physicalness probably say, this is why we don't have vitalism.
Well, what about a democratic, you said a male animism. What about the concept of a democratic animism? And you could make the argument that it could be feminine. Because the old argument between the cultural historians who say matriarchy is the was the best social construction in the ancient world, the others say patriarchy. Well, feminists came up with the idea that matriarchy preceded patriarchy, and it was somewhat of a better social system. And the people who supported patriarchy came back and said, well, you feminists, historians, you don't have any legs to stand on because it's still archy. It's just the opposite of the repressive system of a patriarchy. Well, then along comes, you mentioned her, Rayan Eisler, a cultural historian. She writes A Chalice and a Blade. And she says that it wasn't, yes, it was, when you, she doesn't like the term matriarchy for that Bronze Age culture complex. She likes gynomy. Or matricentered cultures, and not because of the connotations
or
of matriarchy. So she says it's a partner.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right.
So we would look at it today because the equality between men and women as more, not women rule, but an egalitarian social order. And so why not then a democratic animism? From the ground up, not from the top down.
Go ahead.
There's a fascinating system of governance in the Iroquois nation.
Mm-hmm.
Still alive today. It's just brilliant, and there are a number of good books about it. The French call them the Iroquois. They call themselves the Haudenosaunee, and it's a League of Nations, the original League of Nations. The Mohawk, the Oneida, the Onondaga, the Tuscarora,
Iroquois,
the Seneca. The French call them the Iroquois. They call themselves the Haudenosaunee.
Right.
And they basically went into hiding for hundreds of years after Columbus came and the Tree of Peace fell, and then came out again in the 70s. There's a really good book that came out in the 70s when they came out called Basic Call to Consciousness. When they came to the United Nations and said, hey, we're here, we've just been underground for hundreds of years protecting our traditions, but we're here, we have a message. The short story is that they were at bloody civil war from Ohio to New York and Canada to Tennessee for hundreds of years, so long of a war that they couldn't even remember what they were fighting over. Sounds familiar.
Worse than Vietnam.
And they, you know, they had clubs and weapons that were built for one purpose, to kill people. And essentially this person came into the world and had this spiritual mission to unite all the warring people. And their name is the Peacemaker. They have another name that's only said in ceremony, but we can refer to them as the Peacemaker. Built a white stone canoe that then went across the Great Lakes, where this person met Hiawatha. You may have heard of Hiawatha. Giving you the abridged version. Long story short, united all the people to put down their weapons and created a system of lasting peace for hundreds of years until for a number of reasons, but their system was very brilliant and very elegant, and I still think holds a lot of potential for us today. And our system of governance in the U.S. was largely, I'd say, butchered on their system. It wasn't exactly copied, it was butchered. The Electoral College is the Klan grandmothers, right? The Klan grandmothers who watch the little ones on the playground and can say, oh, that one's really power hungry. That one's not gonna be our leader. They wanna be our leader, but they're definitely not gonna be our leader. This one, they're a natural diplomat. And so when they come of age, we're gonna tap them on the shoulder and say, sorry, guess what? We want you to be our leader. And then the young one, you know, they're gonna say, oh no, I don't wanna be your leader because that means I have to give my entire life to my village. You know, it's like a service. It's like you've lost your life to then be a political leader. Yeah, it's just a brilliant system. And you can look, I forget what dollar bill it is, but if you look, there's all these, you know, white men signing some declaration, and on the balcony are all these Mohawk being like, don't do it! You almost got it right! But, you know, it's not supposed to be two-thirds, it's supposed to be consensus. It's not supposed to be white men who left for college are supposed to be the grandmothers and all these other things.
Well, there's been a lot of historical speculation about the, you know, whether or not there was some sort of aboriginal democratic idea in the minds of our founding fathers. So there, some historians say Franklin and Jefferson got their ideas from the Iroquois Confederacy about democracy. I don't know how true it is, but I've read it.
Franklin was fluent in Mohawk. He was mentored by the Mohawk for 10 years. There's a great book, The Founding Finaglers, about this. Also, The White Roots of Peace. The White Roots of Peace. That's a good one. And then I'd also point out Professor John Brown Childs from UCSC, he's an emeritus, wrote a book, Transcommunality, which brings the principles of peacemaking into a sort of modern context in terms of coalition building in the globalized world.
Yeah, that's great.
Well, I'd like to build on that just one thing. Claire and I won't be here.
We're going to Utah.
We're going to Utah for a month. So, but I want to leave with this Columbus and Other Cannibals. and it's written by a Native American, introduction by Derek Jensen. And,
oh, wow.
And what it's really saying to me is that there's something very much more basic, and you used the word infected, and that's what, there's a word for it that the Native Americans use called wetiko, which basically means he's seeing that this whole European culture is more or less infected by a kind of a virus like that has caused us to do, how can we do these terrible things? We can't even understand it, but I think what you're talking about, Paul, in terms of the vitalism versus the physicalism, is a piece of this infection, mm-hmm. that the scientific worldview is really part of this bigger picture of a kind of a wetiko infection. So I really recommend this book, and it's been taken up by another book called Dispelling Wetiko, which is more psychological. But I would like to leave that because with what's going on, because a lot of what I'm hearing in this dialogue between physicalism and vitalism is also this, the fact that scientists have been infected. What we would call scientism is like an infection of this wetiko disease, and that's what I'd like to emphasize.
See, my version of the infection is self-destruction.
Yeah.
So I've worried about that for a long time, trying to figure out what is the dynamic of self-destruction. Why should we be living in a historic era that's characterized by the late stage of the self-destruction of industrial society?
Exactly.
And so, and then the further line on that is, and it's a world above the given world of nature. Okay, that gives you some sense of its self-destructiveness because it's unattached. It floats above the world of nature, as it were, like the industrial city. I grew up in Milwaukee, which is a major industrial city in the country, and I was torn between the farm and the city because my father was the son of Norwegian immigrant farmers, and we visited the farm often. And so I have a real sense of the industrial city. What's meant by that is the world above the given world of nature. We went into that last time. So this theme of self-destruction is such a peculiar one, and where does that come from? And a variant of it is reflections on the tragedy of culture. What does that mean? Why should culture be a tragedy? And why should our culture look like a tragedy once one examines it? And I was amazed that my favorite word, tumos, which we'll get into at some point before we're done, because for me it's the term for vital, and it's right here, and it means the soul, and it's one of these lost words, the words that have lost their coinage, because we've lost the reference point, which is here. This is empty for a lot of people. They don't have any sense that this is their soul, that this is where their centered self resides, partly because we're so mind and brain oriented. We've lost this root. And one of the meanings of tumas is wrath. And it's used for the wrath of God in the Bible, which can be defined as our vitality turned against ourselves. That was an eye-opener as far as what wrath meant.
Right. From the same root as vitalism is, vitality, that's interesting, vitality turned against itself.
And that's wrath. Now, the issue is, when I give you this whole pitch here, about this as being the vital center and the center for one's vital drives and so on, which is critical to the Platonic depiction of consciousness. This is the center for Platonic consciousness. And the word is thymos, T-H-Y-M-O-S, from which we get the thymos. Which is one definition of thymos. And it has a double vector. So the upward vector is eros. And that means the unreflective striving toward what is the true, the good, and the beautiful, the unreflective striving toward what is noble. That's the erotic ascent, often depicted as a chariot ride to the highest ideals and forms. And the downward vector, I've named Ate. And Ate is the eldest daughter of Zeus. Her myth is told in the Iliad. And she is her name is ruin or delusion. And she is the figure of our vitality turned against ourselves. Because she is the one who leads us through the blindness of self-destructive acts. And that's the downward vector of thymos. And it's terrific. It's the cognate in our word infatuation, which captures the meaning of Ate in terms of the rash acts that come from the blindness of desire, the blinding of desire. So that's our vitality turned against ourselves.
And what does unreflective mean in the Greek? What is the unreflective
striving? Well, because it's here rather than here.
Oh, okay. So it's not negative.
It's pre-reflective, or, you know, the basis of, you know, the root of it.
Would we say today the unselfconscious striving? Or?
Yeah, you could just say unconscious striving, because it's pre-reflective, but unreflective. And it's always characterized as the courage of knights. You know, I mean, in other words, it's almost given by virtue of one's breeding. You know, it's instinctual. So you don't have to think about it. It's spontaneous as far as what's given to you. And it means courage or vitality or spiritedness. You see, it's the resolution of the mind-body problem. And it's right here in the thymus gland. That's our spirited center. And spirited meaning our biological vitality. That's what soul has lost and why it lost its coinage. Because soul became kind of vaporized, just like the word spirit. Mm-hmm. And it lost its bodily connection, which is what soul should mean.
Can you talk a little bit more about vitality turning against itself in the downward vector? Because for me, my connotation of vitality is it's positive, it's good.
Right.
You know, and that idea of, wow, vitality being a bad thing or being turning against yourself, having a downward vector, mm-hmm. I would never have thought of having that vitality would have a downward vector. So can you talk a little bit more about, in fact, I'm trying to think, God, in what way could vitality be a bad thing unless
evil.
It becomes infatuation? If it gets expressed in infatuation or blind desire, vitality.
Think of an example. Who would be an exemplar of phenomenal vitality, of great spiritedness? And the immediate figure comes to mind is Alcibiades in the Greek context, the great student of Socrates, except he turns against him. And so here you have someone of the greatest vitality, and he was a beautiful human being. Everybody was in awe of him. But he somehow was impossible of you know, being tempered. I mean, he was somebody who had no control over his impulses. He once slapped his father in public. I mean, it was a big event because his father, I guess father-in-law, excuse me, father-in-law was a famous Athenian. And anyhow, his encounter with Socrates is one of the great encounters of all time because he sets out to seduce Socrates. He's going to screw him. And they sleep together, and instead he's seduced by Socrates non-genitally. I mean, Socrates actually transmits to him, but he rejects it. And he turns against it, and he's led into his own self-destruction.
That's almost Shakespearean, huh?
Exactly.
Comic book.
That's what I was
saying.
Say that again?
It's almost Shakespearean or comic book.
Yeah.
A brilliant scientist.
Right.
That could be doing good for science, but turns bad for some reason, you know.
Well,
so why is it that one's talents turn against you? You know, where you I was trying to think of that yesterday. We were talking about, celebrities that self-destruct. You know, take Elvis or
Charlie Sheen.
You know, Marilyn Monroe or people that can't handle their fame, and their fame actually does them in. They're destroyed by it. Hmm. Now that. Could be an example of what we're talking about. I'm not quite sure yet, but there are people of great vitality, of great talent, that's so immeasurable as far as the way they cut their swath through their lives, and yet they're destroyed by what they are.
But what about, he said Shakespearean, I was thinking of Othello, or what about one of the Richards, King Richards, I'm sorry,
or
King
Macbeth.
Henry's?
Macbeth is a real good one.
Yeah, that would be good. And
see, it's the imp and impulse. I
right.
can't get over that.
But in that sense...
I thought that was one of the cleverest things I've ever thought. Here you got this word impulse to talk about, you know, wayward desires, and it's the bane of teenagers. You know, I mean, I drove a car 100 miles an hour down a street in Milwaukee. What the hell was that about? I mean, it's totally suicidal. And I was having a great time. You know, but I should have died because it was so reckless. Okay, the recklessness of impulsiveness contains the word imp. And Ate is the name of the imp, an impulse. She's the one who drives you to your self-destruction in this downward vector of Tumas, whereas it should be the upward vector where your vitality is carried in a sublimated way to the true, the good, and the beautiful. That's the Greek view.
And to bring it back to the feminist, you know, the discussion around gender, you could say it's uninitiated male behavior. In a Native American context, it would be younger brother, right? It'd be the uninitiated sort of boy, and the theory would then expand to say our whole culture being patriarchal. It's not just patriarchal, it's in particular young, uninitiated male behavior, whereas the initiated older male uncle, right, or father, would be much more nurturing and generative and whole.
And bringing this character of vitality against oneself, character who represents whether it's Othello or Macbeth or somebody, bringing it back to vitalism versus physicalism and that history, when you think about it, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, Dr. Frankenstein, is that kind of a figure. In the sense he has this, he has this genius to him, and even the dark side of it, what they used to call the inventive demon of geniuses, you know, he has this striving. I mean, he's doing this because he thinks he's going to help mankind, but his whole psychology and his historical place in the story, I think, lends itself to a good example of a character who is vitality turned against oneself. And that, therefore, we can apply it to our whole history of...
Yeah, but Frankenstein isn't a real human being.
No, I'm talking about Dr. Frankenstein,
okay.
The inventor.
Okay, now I want to go from there to Faust, because I wanted to get into Goethe somewhat today. So that's a perfect opening for it. And also, back to Manuel, I had a hard time thinking about good demons. You know, like you were saying, good impulses. Because to me, the imp and impulse was always the demon that led one astray and was self-destructive. But the Greeks had the notion of daemon. They spell it D-A-E-M-O-N, which is equivalent to our guardian angel. And it's, we don't have much truck with guardian angels in ordinary conversation or consciousness that I know of, whereas we're much more prone to think about, you know, bad impulses and just self-destructive recklessness and so on. So that's an odd thing about, I had to kind of correct myself in thinking about the imp and impulse as being good. You know, as far as erotic sublimation is concerned, that's another difficult term, because erotic for us means sexual, whereas for the Greeks, it meant the striving toward what was ideal and what was noble. And that's probably another aspect of our culture, that we don't really have much of that. We don't know what it means to strive toward what is noble, because we don't have a nobility as a reference point. Mm. And
this is so intriguing to me, this whole idea of the downward vector and why, you know, I'm always at Penn University trying to figure out why Republicans think the way they do. You know, how really smart, smart people, way smarter than me.
Yeah, what is wrong with that?
And I'm always trying to, how do they do that? It's almost like a downward vector. Like, you know, they've got the brains, but maybe they don't have the heart to think the way
that's. And what's even worse is they get to look that way.
Yes.
Like McConnell, I mean, it's like his tumors has just gone down to his knees, and as a result, he's lost his chin.
So I want to defend down for a second here. This is a Jungian sort of framework mixed with Bill Plotkin, that author I mentioned last time. So up, spirit, oneness. Right, we're talking about unity and one.
Mm-hmm.
Spirit might be said to be the soul of the universe. So the middle world, then, the realm of ego. Our conversation right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
My existence, my identity, all of our identities, and this conversation, the middle world. And then down, the realm of the soul, the depth of things, underwater. And it's about multiplicity. It's about the uniqueness of everything, the soul of that tree, the soul of my hat, the soul of me, the soul of you, that one unique thing I was born into the world with, and my great purpose in life is to discover it and be discovered by it, and then to learn how to deliver it into the world and to infuse the world with my soul. Many would say that's our task, is to do that. And so there's this tension: can the one and the many coexist, right? And how can they coexist?
Mm.
On one hand, we are loving our multiplicity in our soul, our unique souls. At the same time, we're also striving towards this oneness and this spirit. And so I would say in our culture, by and large, it's all middle world. Spirit is totally trivialized, but at least spirit is somewhat talked about. We've got like Eckhart Tolle and stuff like that, whereas soul is not even on the map. It is shadow, it is hell, it is like, don't go there, don't talk about it.
Unless you're black.
Unless you're black, right?
Yeah, they've got an option monopoly on it.
Yeah, right.
So you have soul food and soul music and the whole...
Soul brother,
the whole movement is dynamic of soul.
And yet we're in a racist culture.
Yeah.
So, you know, they've got a monopoly on it, but do you want that monopoly?
No.
There's a lot of weight.
Especially when it
But it's funny that the term is relegated to that.
Yeah.
And we've lost it.
Yeah, interesting. I didn't put that corollary.
Yeah.
Yeah, the black people
can... And they manifest it. And in a way, it suggests pre-literate. You know, they're not spoiled by rational self-consciousness in the way that white people are. So they still have their vitality intact. And it's a peculiar issue. John.
Yeah, it also reminds me of how there are common complaints among the people who are well-knowledged about Obama administration, with blaming the officials who represent Democrats who use race baiting when there are people who are not claimed to be establishment Democrats who help colored people, like this Clive and Bundy story. That's when racism had lost its meaning into a politically empty theater.
Anybody get that?
No.
No.
I can relate to it in the sense that I think that Republican and Democrat is a way to keep people separated. Mm. And that really there's another axis that we need to deal with, and it has more to do with whatever you, it's hard to talk about, but it has something to do with evil. We have to try to understand something about evil. Why is it that there are people that can do some of the things that we can't even imagine doing? We can't even hardly believe that some people would do some of these things. And I think Republican and Democrat is a way to keep people separated and to be doing, I like the words you used, John, I'm not sure. So you said like an empty drama or...
empty political theater.
Yeah.
Yeah, it clearly evident in George W. Bush and Obama administration, even there's some statistics with youth not wanting to associate themselves. 44% independent, that's a huge number. I cannot remember the statistics or anything, but I'm glad that I'm out of it, because there's even Jesse Ventura written a book called Democrats and the Bloodlickers. Let's stop this two-party gang fight.
You know, I think John makes a good point. John, you make a good point of bringing up the Bundy story. I'm not so sure about the racism. I'm sure it's there, but as far as for our class, there is a connection there, because like all good libertarians that came of age in the early 90s, the kind of libertarian when you scratch them, you find a Republican underneath, what they were really on about during that time was that they didn't want anybody telling them what they could do with their private property. Why? Because they felt under attack by these tree-hugging environmentalists, that they had these owls that were protected on their land, and therefore they had to do what the government said, or some sort of quote-unquote endangered species. Well, it turns out this whole thing comes out of not only that the guy was grazing his land, but the reason that the Land Management Bureau got uppity about it is that there was an endangered turtle on that grazing property. They didn't want him, and he took exception to that. So this connects to our class in the sense that you have a culture that doesn't revere animals as conscious or as worthy of living as human beings, and that we could do anything we want to them. So that story is part of the legacy that we're studying about here in the class.
Even when Clive and Bundy does his best to keep the turtle population thriving, because
the cow dung?
Yes.
That isn't...
You guys. Let's get off of Bundy.
Okay.
Let's get back to Gerda.
I'm bummed because I love Gerda, but I have another meeting I got to go to, so I got to bow out right now.
Okay, you're
another
excused.
Stimulating conversation.
Yeah, thank you for your contribution.
Paul, are you familiar with the word duende? The Spanish word duende? It's very similar to timos.
And what's the word?
D-U-E-N-D-E. Duende.
Duende.
D-U-E-N-D-E.
Huh.
It's a very similar word to by Spanish.
What language is it?
Spanish.
What?
Spanish.
Spanish, okay.
D-U-E-N-D-E.
Duende.
One of the ways they look about it, the way I first heard it was, there was a contest, they were having a festival, and they were having all these beautiful ladies go up on stage to see who was going to be crowned the queen of the festival. And these beautiful ladies go on stage, and the judges are all going, no, 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 no. And this old crone goes up there, but she has such duende that all the judges go, she's the queen. And then also, if you've ever heard flamenco singers and the way they emote, and they're almost about ready to pop, you know, I'm sure the best flamenco singer in the world, if he could die on stage as he was crying his pain or his love, you know, people would stand up and applaud, oh my God, it's the best performance ever. That's Duende. So I just was, somehow something made me think when he was talking about soul, because I associate Duende with soul, and I realized Duende is sort of a Spanish word for Timos.
You got it. It reminds me of Fado.
Yeah, well, Lorca, people should consult Lorca, the poet, because he wrote a whole essay on this about the Duende concept,
really?
Fado, and in flamenco.
No kidding.
But he was trying to apply it as a cultural term for an aesthetic perception and a way to see a lot of arts. He was trying to expand it.
Aren't there some great paintings that are called Duende, like
maybe
by Goya?
Yeah, now Duende is getting attributed because of Lorca's essay on Duende. It's supposed to be untranslatable. It means you'd have to put a bunch of English notions together, like aloneness. It's all about passion, the depth of one's passion, aloneness, a longing, an indescribable yearning or longing for something, you know, that usually can't be fulfilled.
There's another Portuguese word that's related to this besides fado, and it's saudade, which is sublime melancholy, sublime longing. The Japanese have a term, I don't remember, for like the beauty and the sublime sadness of seeing cherry blossoms fall, about how it's sad and beautiful at the same time. They have a term for that, you know, that you need 20 English words for the one Japanese word, or the duende, or the fado, or the saudade.
Well, the way they describe this indescribable longing is in the same some of the same terms you describe the erotic striving,
mm-hmm.
almost. So there might be a connection.
So the saddest part is Scandinavian melancholy.
Oh, no, they're just plain melancholy. Nothing pretty about their melancholy.
So you go in Finnish?
I had an uncle who did that.
Do they suck it in rather than, you know, go? I mean, that's so typically Norwegian. I mean, I'm sure it's probably Swedish as well. But instead of going, yeah, they go.
That's sort of like the Scandinavians are sort of depressed in a sense. The weather has a lot to do with it.
Yeah.
But it's also a value. It's a real value to them that, you know, if you are not like that, or, you know, the Spaniards and all those people, they're just the other, you know.
Mediterraneans.
Yeah, they just can't have good time unless they are drunk, you know. Or something that, you know, they don't have to think about their ego, you know. But I had this image of the epidemic, epidemic, not enough epidemic, but partial epidemic of bankers committing suicide. So they are very driven people and successful people, and they kill themselves. You know, so it kind of fits into this.
We catch on over here with some of our corporate robber bears.
Yeah, there are so many of them.
Okay, let's move from Frankenstein to Faust. So, I mean, you get the parallel columns, I hope, when you go from Galileo through Descartes to Newton to, you know, the whole development of modern science in its physicalistic mode. Then the other column goes from, you know, the botanic gardens of the Renaissance eventually to Goethe. And it was such a hit to confront or encounter Goethe as a result of Chadwick's development of biodynamics here, because Steiner, from whom Chadwick got biodynamics as a method of food and flower production, was a great Goethe scholar, as asked to edit the scientific works of Goethe at the Goethe Archive in Weimar. So that's what set him up for learning about Goethe's botany. And Goethe spent a lot of time thinking about botany. He coined the word morphology to talk about plant structure. And he had this odd notion of an Ur plant as part of his morphological interests. And the Ur plant, it's characteristically German. It's really a metaphysical plant. And it is an exemplar of plant development. And Goethe was especially interested in the formation of stem to leaf and carried on about that. He wrote an interesting small essay called The Metamorphosis of Plants, in which he develops his notion of plant development, plant evolution, and plant morphology. So the Ur plant, U-R, was the primal plant, the original plant, and that was a big deal for him. He really liked theorizing about the Ur plant. And there was this great encounter between Goethe and Schiller. When they finally met, they kind of half avoided one another for a period of time as if it was, reverse magnetism. And then finally one night they met, and it was a terrific encounter for both of them. And they spent the night talking about Goethe's notion of an Ur plant. They just somehow got into that, and at one critical moment, Schiller said, well, that's just an idea. And Goethe got extremely agitated and said, well, then isn't it odd that I can see it with my own eyes? And Schiller didn't quite get it. I mean, that something that was so ideational could be at the same time perceivable. And that was Goethe's whole point, that he saw the Ur plant in other plants. And it was as though they were informed by the Ur plant. And that's a move that Schiller somehow couldn't make because he must have prided himself on being empirical. And his empirical approach to such issues didn't include that kind of perception that Goethe had. So that became a great debate and discussion. There's a literature all about this encounter between the two of them and the different mentality of Goethe opposed to Schiller, as if Schiller was a kind of typical scientist, even though he was a major poet and dramatist. So Goethe, at one point, he's really the most important man in Germany. He's the embodiment of German letters. He's the national poet of the stature of a Homer and a Dante. And he is a man of so many parts. He was head of the Bureau of Mines because of his mineralogical interests. And he was head of all of the court activities, theater, music, dance, and developed stuff in all of those areas. I mean, you can't quite believe how active he was and all the hats he wore and the multiple talents that he manifested. And he became a kind of exemplar of the German as far as talented creativity goes. Well, one day he dropped out. It's as if it all was too much for him. And he just walks. He takes off. You know, where's Goethe? I don't know. He was here, an hour ago. And he walked to Italy. Just took off. Didn't tell anybody he was going. And it's his famous Italian journey, which became, again, a kind of exemplar for German youth who followed in the footsteps of Goethe in a trip to Italy. Italy was warm and sunny and vital. And it drew Germans who then, in their young adulthood, would follow Goethe's footsteps to Italy. And so in the Botanic Garden in Padua, he seems to designate a palm tree. I don't know if he really called it the Ur plant, but in any event, the Paduans named the palm tree after Goethe, called it Goethe's palm. And it was a dwarf palm, even though at that point it was over 200 years old. So I'd say it was probably the height of this room. And when I saw it 100 years later, I went there in 1976 about. I took a trip to Europe, to Germany, and then to Italy. I went with a friend of mine, and we actually followed the footsteps of Goethe to follow his Italian journey. So we go to Padua, and it's called the oldest botanical garden in the Western world, although that's disputed. But in any event, it's a phenomenal garden because it's based on a cosmological design of concentric circles. So it's a cosmos unto itself and a marvelous place to visit. And here's this palm tree under glass. They built a glass tower to enshrine it. And I'll show you a picture of that at some point. I actually did when we looked at the slides a couple times back. And so Goethe then went on from Padua to Palermo. I think that was the end point of his southern journey. And in Palermo, he's sitting in the Botanic Garden of Palermo. And he has a copy of the Odyssey in his pocket. So he's reading the Odyssey in his Botanic Garden, and he comes upon toward the end of the Odyssey, a story about Odysseus' bed. And when I read about that, I thought, I associated the Ur plant to Odysseus' bed. I thought that was really clever. Because Odysseus staked out his bed around a growing olive tree. And the olive tree, per se, isn't the Ur plant, but the whole symbolism of Odysseus' bed, made or developed around a growing olive tree. He took three other olive trees and made the other three posts of the bed and a leather thonged mattress dyed crimson. And that was his bed, one post of which is a growing olive tree. And so when he returns to Ithaca, disguised as a beggar, the olive tree bed is their secret sign that enables Penelope to realize that it really is Odysseus come back. She's reluctant to recognize him. Telemachus, the son, criticizes her and mother, how can you keep from realizing that Odysseus come back to us? Well, she's afraid it's a god in disguise. And she's waiting for their secret sign to be revealed for her to recognize him. And so she calls out to their handmaiden, I think Anticly or whatever her name is, to move the bed out in the hallway for the stranger, and they'll continue the discussion the next morning. And Odysseus says, how can you do that? Who can move my bed? And he tells a story of how he made his bed around this growing olive tree, and then Penelope, of course, knows that this disguised beggar is, in fact, Odysseus returned to her. And so they embrace, and it's one of the great moments in literature, and it's often been referred to, because the symbolism of the bed rooted in the ground with this one olive tree is so potent. And so here's Goethe sitting in the Botanic Garden of Palermo reflecting on the bed of Odysseus. At the same time, he's thinking about the Ur plant. And for me, that was the vital root of existence, in a nutshell.
Did Goethe ever write about what possessed him to just split?
Huh?
Did Goethe ever write about what possessed him to just go to Italy? Like,
no, I don't think so.
I would love to know why somebody like that,
yeah, drops
what would
out.
Make him go over the edge?
Right. I think it he got overloaded. And he doesn't seem like anybody that would have not had the capacity to deal with anything, because that's the kind of life he lived.
Did he ever enter back into that, or he never got back?
Yeah,
into
he got right back into it when he came
he
back. But he was gone for over 2 years.
Oh, that's a big break.
Yeah. And so the Italian journey is a great record of those 2 years. And it's in print. You can get it. And the slogan is Et in Arcadia Ego. That's Goethe's Italian journey slogan. And that's where we got it from as far as applying it to the garden and the Arcadian tradition that matches the tradition of Eden.
Constructive nervous breakdown.
Sabbatical.
Yeah.
Sabbatical.
Yeah, that's what he did. And what's also peculiar about Goethe, I just heard this secondhand from a friend of mine who worked on Goethe at Harvard. She said that every hour of his life was recorded. He's the most observed and recorded human being that ever lived. I'm like, okay, that's amazing. So they must have known early on that this was the primary German of all time, and they took that kind of interest in him.
He's like a poor person.
Yeah, and it's kind of reminiscent of Mozart, you know, where Mozart showed up early. Like, what was he, like four or so? And then three or four, when he could already play the piano, and he learned how to play the piano backwards. I mean, he put his hands behind his back and could play, just to startle people, when he was three or four. And they were so in awe of Mozart's talent that was so manifestly obvious that they thought he was the reincarnation of Jesus Christ. That they didn't have, not quite know how else to think about it. The genius was so evident. So Goethe was like that. So what does he do then? He writes the major epic of our line of thought, namely, the man who sells his soul to the devil in order to unveil nature's mysteries. And it's ironic to me that Freud goes to a public lecture when he's a young man, say 20 or 19, and he hears, read out loud by the lecturer, Goethe's Ode to Nature. And he's so moved by this evocation of the goddess Natura that he decides in that moment to enter the medical sciences and unveil nature's mysteries, which is a little indelicate. I mean, can't you see Freud kind of picking up a skirt, you know, looking for a Freudian slip? I never got over that. I mean, that was amazing that, you know, the great psychoanalyst should have been motivated to enter nature's mysteries through the physicalist laboratory, which is where he wound up, under the tutelage of Brucke, who was one of the members of the Physicalist Society in Berlin and one of the formulators of the oath that was taken in blood. Freud becomes his student. And his task is to dissect the nervous system of a certain order of fish in order to develop a theory of the neuron. So he's very early in the neuron investigation, the neurological investigation of what has now led to consciousness, the neurological investigation of consciousness. And that's part of the problem with Freud, is that you have this scientific side, the scientistic physicalist side that he was tutored by, that he studied under, with one of the great figures, Brucke. And then on the other side, you know, his whole effort to understand human culture and human consciousness, which, you know, I'm willing to say is Freud's vitalist side. He never really repressed that or dismissed it in his efforts, and he wrote some of the great treatises on a theory of culture that we have in our literature. So you have this mixed discourse in Freud of the physicalist and the vitalist.
And it would be the scientist and the humanist, because of his knowledge of mythology, that he worked into his psychoanalysis.
Yeah, see, and that'd be the whole vitalist side as far as I'm concerned. And so when I did my thesis at Harvard on Freud under Eric Erickson, I had a real hard time with it because I had no understanding of the physicalist side. I didn't know this whole physicalist development and how strong it was in Freud and why Freud wanted a kind of mechanical model for consciousness that was based on electricity and hydraulics and physicalist models for consciousness.
And even people have talked about his terminology is so, you know, like cathexis. And it's so,
yeah, all that stuff. See, and that was all physicalist terminology. And I was coming in from, you know, the other side and had a real struggle with what that was all about. But there were monographs that came out about that time disclosing Freud's whole background with the physicalist school, his studying under Brucke, and so on. So I was beginning to pick it up. And then Paul Ricoeur, wonderful French philosopher, wrote his Freud and Philosophy, which I had occasion to edit. And in that book, Ricoeur distinguishes between Freud's physicalism, which he calls energetics, and Freud's vitalism, which he calls Freud's hermeneutics. namely the side of interpretation, cultural interpretation. Hermeneutics is the science of interpretation. It comes off of biblical studies. It's named after Hermes, the thief, who brought messages between the gods and human beings. So hermeneutics would be initially the study of the Bible and how to interpret the Bible, and then it became a general theme in terms of texts, whatever, you know, especially literary texts. So that was clever, I thought, and I kind of intuited what Ricoeur meant by those two, even though I hadn't got the physical vitalist scheme clearly in mind until I came here. So back to Goethe. So what's the corollary of Freud hearing Goethe's ode to nature? As far as I'm concerned, it's Goethe going to a rock shop and running into Wohler, the guy who synthesized urea, and in a way undermined everything Goethe stood for as a vitalist. And this is mentioned in a book I got on the lives of chemists, where Wohler is looking at rocks. They were both rock hounds. And here comes Goethe. And I think they rubbed elbows or something. And I had this notion that Goethe intuited who he had inadvertently encountered at the rock shop and went home and finished Faust. He was stuck for a while in terms of the second part of Faust. And so he realized he had met him. The guy had whose work helped undermine the integrity of organic nature through its collapse into the inorganic through artificial synthesis. I mean, unbelievable. So these linkages are really fun. You know, the Brucke physicalist society linkage to Freud and the encounter of Goethe and Wohler in a rock shop.
We should tell people that Goethe didn't originate Faust. It was a legend.
Yeah, right. Just like Hamlet.
And the legend was, by the way, bringing it back to our scientism problem. Mary Shelley was well aware not only of the legends of Faust, but also very influenced by Goethe's Faust. And I can't help see the way she describes Dr. Frankenstein. I can't help but see that Faust, he's
yeah.
very Faustian.
I think to get the idea of Faust is like some guy who made a deal with the devil. If you are finished with your thing, you get sent down to hell or something. Faust.
I don't know. Does he?
I don't know.
He gets his comeuppance. I can't remember exactly how that happens. I should reread it. But it's partly related to Vogelin's notion that scientists sacrifice their balls, spiritual balls, let's say, for the kingdom of science. That's selling your soul to the devil and the kind of pact that entails. So Faust is an expression of what Vogelin is pointing to, and it's this anti-spiritualist revolt. Okay, you don't have any of that in Goethe. I mean, Goethe is to holistic, organic thought, you know, what Newton, let's say, is to physicalist reduction, to, you know, the combination of physical and chemical forces. So It was another eye-opener to see Goethe go up against Newton. I mean, that was really amazing to hit. And he did it in his interest in a theory of color. He went up against Newton's optics. So think of physicalistic optics on color versus vitalist optics and a theory of color in Goethe. And that conflict is still going on. It's a really remarkable contemporary literature on the respective theories of color. And I think the tide is turning in favor of Goethe because of Newton's reductionism and his physicalist bias regarding color. And I've tried reading it. It's a technical field, and I get sort of lost fairly quickly. But I keep thinking that buying books will give me the knowledge they contain. I thought I'd learn German by buying about 10 German language books, and I never, all I learned was, you know, aber etwas fehlt, which means something's missing, namely the soul.
I found a good explanation of the essence of the conflict. This author on the book, it's in the book, Goethe on Science, he puts it this way. The color theory was published in 1810, and
it's real late.
Okay, he mentions that it has a somewhat ambivalent place in the history of science, and there's still a lot of heated controversy about it. But he says the reason for it, he says, and I quote, "For it is a model of a type of scientific thinking utterly opposed to that of Newton, whose optics dominated the field in Goethe's day. The essential difference in the methods of the two men is that Newton sought to explain the phenomenon of color in terms of measurable angles of refrangibility."
Right.
I haven't had a chance to look that up. Is it like refractability?
Yeah,
okay. The angles, the measurable angles of refractability of colorless rays of light, whereas Goethe had no desire to reduce our color phenomena to what was measurable but colorless. His approach consisted in trying to understand color in its own terms, and in terms of how we exactly experience it arising in nature.
Yeah, so you get, in a way, the symbolism of color in Goethe. While you're reading that, I thought of my teacher Tillich, who got diverticulitis, and it's a serious illness. He was in the hospital, and he was critical, and they thought he might die. But there was a red beam in his hospital room, and he talked about what it meant for him to focus on this red beam and how it kept him alive. And it was such a testimony to the power of red, as far as he was concerned, and as he understood it and experienced it. I never forgot that. And that was what Goethe was after. So he carried on experiments with prisms. He wasn't opposed to experimentation as a way of gaining knowledge, and his prism experiments are well known, and carried his studies far. And so anyhow, that's an excellent spot to compare the two. And what also was the case with Goethe is that he wanted to overcome the subject-object conflict, as if he wanted a kind of knowledge that transcended the subject-object split. He didn't want detached knowledge that led to measurement and quantification and all of the physicalist attributes. He wanted understanding. He wanted participation. He wanted participatory knowledge. And all the way on that spectrum. So he's got an interesting essay on overcoming the subject-object split. He was perfectly aware of how that was the main model from Descartes on for scientific inquiry. And because he was an organic thinker, he wanted to think in wholes and not in parts. He wanted to see things, we'd call it systems theory today. He was an early systems theorist, and you could say helped pioneer the field. So that's Goethe. And so our dear Rudolf Steiner, as a young man, makes his career by reading Goethe's scientific works, editing it, doing a brilliant job, and developing biodynamics from Goethe's botanical studies. And it gets transmitted through Steiner to here, thanks to Chadwick. Another remarkable anecdote about Steiner is that when Nietzsche was about to die, he was getting old, he was insane because of syphilis, and he was bedridden, and Nietzsche's sister contacts Steiner to come to do the Nietzsche archive and to edit Nietzsche's works, which he didn't do, but he's to be interviewed. So he comes and he's discussing this with Nietzsche's sister, and she says, would you like to get a look at him? Steiner says, sure, yeah, sure. So she takes him down the hallway and opens the door, and there's Nietzsche in his bed, half sitting up, and Steiner describes it in a way that makes the hair in the back of your head stand up, about how he sees Nietzsche's consciousness hovering above his head because he's deranged and mad. And he describes that. And whoa, and then she closes the door again. Steiner meets Goethe.
Nietzsche meets Nietzsche.
Steiner meets Nietzsche.
Does anybody know what Goethe sometimes called his different way of observing nature or participating in nature as opposed to the inductive and later deductive?
Do you know?
Yes, it's in this book. It's a quote from Goethe. I love you. You mentioned empiricism that we have. Well,
Gestalt would be a term. Gestalt approach.
He doesn't want to give it a totally different name that the scientists use. He wants to tease them with their own kinds of terminology. He says, quote, there is a delicate empiricism. That's what he calls it.
Okay.
He calls it a delicate empiricism, which makes itself utterly identical with the object, thereby becoming true theory. But this enhancement of our mental powers belongs to a highly evolved age. And so here we are, we're ready, we're evolved enough, we can do the delicate.
So it's a self-transcending issue. Yeah. I mean, he had that in mind.
It's physicalism light.
There's another anecdote about Steiner that knocks me out. Because he was clairvoyant, this is attributed to him. He could do what I suppose we'd call astral travel. And so he was worried about Hitler. I mean, it's as if the age produced two totally antithetical figures, Hitler and Steiner. I mean, they're interesting to think of together. And so Steiner wanted to really attack and undermine Hitler. And it's reported that he was able to actually project himself to interfere with seances that Hitler had with his astrologers. Hmm. Why?
Well, as I understand, that was the reason that Steiner wanted to do that was because Hitler ran the Anthroposophist out of Germany. That's what I understood.
Yeah, I don't.
That Hitler was down on them, and so he.
Except there were partisans in the Hitler entourage. Rudolf Hess was a partisan of biodynamic farming and promoted it. So, really?
The chicken farmer Hitler would.
Yeah, so that was one.
That's problematic.
But because he pissed off Hitler through these interferences, Hitler burned his center down.
Yeah,
they burned. He burned down the Goethe Annum, and Steiner had to rebuild it.
He did. Not the same material either.
That's what you get with fooling around with Hitler's seances.
Yeah. Have you read the thing that he wrote about Caspar Hauser?
Yeah, that's such an amazing aspect.
That's another whole thing.
There's one book on that that's so impenetrable. It's so badly written. You know what are they talking about? Caspar Hauser was this kid that was kept in a basement until he was about 21, and they threw food down to him and so on. It's just one of those stories about it, like a wild boy that was never civilized. I think they made a movie of it. Yeah, they did. What's his name? Werner Herzog, I think, made a film on Caspar Hauser. It's got a funny title. Something about
the wild boy.
No, it's got something. It's got God in the title. And whatever, but it's an amazing movie. It's a terrific movie. And so they finally brought him up from the cellar when he was about 21, and then he became a kind of, what do you call, autodidact, or what do you call somebody who's got a kind of genius for memorizing railroad tables.
Savant.
Savant, yeah, he became a kind of savant. I think he became a piano player, he became a pianist, and actually performed in concert. And so he was one of these funny, almost psychic phenomena for Germany, which attracted a lot of attention. And
Steiner really thought that he was the same thing, this really good person who was born to counteract a lot of the negativity of the world. But the bad guys also
him.
Recognized him and stole him as a baby and put him down below.
The movie is by Werner Herzog. It's called The Enigma of Caspar Hauser.
Oh.
But what's the other title? Something about thanks be to God, but no thanks.
The
what?
No. There's a movie called Aguirre, Wrath of God.
No, no, that's another one.
Okay.
Also by Werner Herzog, but this is the one about Caspar. He's got another title for it, I'm almost certain.
Okay, let me look up, see what it says.
It's something about...
That must be an amazing movie.
It is, so I recommend it.
Yeah.
I've seen it years ago. Yeah, but there's so much of that stuff in Steiner that you don't know what to make of it all. I mean, I get really lost. First of all, reincarnation is an enormous theme in Steiner, which I don't have a hard time with, even though I've known people that have done past lives reduction and so on. So when you see that happen, you kind of wonder, you know, because they make reports that sound like they're, you know, something to at least pay attention to.
You mean past life regression?
Past life regression. And so Steiner is a real complicated figure, partly because of the whole clairvoyant business.
Since the original German title translates to every man for himself and God against them all.
There they go.
Every
man
for himself
and God against them all.
Whoa.
I like that better.
That's beautiful.
There must be a sillier, it must be a sadistic critique of how humankind under this influence of European conquistadorship must have, under the ills of over-reliance of Western influence conquistadorship.
Yeah. What about it?
Explore, exploit the lands.
See, you always, I mean, not always, but you once in a while trigger a real memory in me. I did a thing on Conquistador. It had a major influence on me. His name was Alvar Nunez Cabeza de Vaca. He was a conquistador who came to America under the expedition of Narvaez in you know, like 1520 or 1528. And the expedition foundered. There were three ships, about 300 of them. And they all died except Alvar Nunez and three other companions, and they walked naked and starving from the coast of Florida to Mexico City, and they were the first to cross the whole continent, and it took them 8 years to make the trek.
Wow.
And when he got to Mexico City, he wrote a letter to the King of Spain called Los Naufragios, the shipwrecked ones. And he tells about this whole journey. I actually looked at the original letter. There are about three known extant copies. One was at the New York Public Library. And it's a tremendous spiritual document. And then a marvelous author named Haniel Long wrote what he called an interlinear to the letter of Cabeza de Vaca to the King of Spain, and surfaces what he said was implied between the lines in the original letter. And he picks up the spiritual meaning of Cabeza de Vaca's trek and how reduced he was, and how in the area of El Paso, the Native Americans there who are also starving and naked call upon him to heal their sick or die. And he prays over them and they're healed. And so he's initiated into the herbal medicine of the tribe. And hundreds of natives then accompany him to provide safe conduct to Mexico City. There's a film on this too, called Cabeza de Vaca. It's a very surrealist film, but it's about his whole trek.
And how did this affect his religious beliefs as a Spaniard living in that historical?
Because in the second version, under Haniel Long, which is imaginative, but it's wonderful, he talks about what it was like to be reduced beneath himself, naked and starving, and what it was like to get to Mexico City and put on clothes and shoes and sleep in a bed, and how the healing power that he had manifested when he was beneath himself dissipated. And it's a really remarkable. When I entered the herbal industry, I asked for guidance from Cabeza de Vaca on my career in herbalism. I had to make up a herbal self-instructional manual. I didn't know anything except the herb time. I was bluffing on that one. And so I asked for guidance from Cabeza de Vaca. I wanted to know the origins of the herb tradition in ancient Greece. And this was all, to some extent, under the influence of Chadwick and what the garden meant for me here. And it just happened that I fell into being the executive director of the Herb Trade Association. And it all came through like that. I was answered. I mean, it's as if it was handed to me on a platter. And so that was my conquistador, John.
Wow.
And I'm sorry I didn't publish it because it was such a wonderful story. So anyhow, here we are, folks. So let's pick up a little bit on the Tillich essay for next time and the Vogelin essay. And we have to get into, we've already talked about urea enough. And we have a passage from Kuhn, who's extremely interesting, the guy that wrote The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. I'll talk somewhat about him. And we'll take it from there.